different housekeeping things today. We have a wall today, so if you need to leave the room, you can't go through the wall, so don't do that. We do have a door you can go out over there, so we kind of opened that up for you. All right? Make sure your cell phones are off. Great. Anybody that supported SOTA, they have asked me to give a shout out and say thank you for supporting them. They are thrilled, and this Thanksgiving weekend, and Heather is the advisor, and Miranda is the traditional advisor, and they're clapping because we like support. But the things will be available after the presentation as well. Today we have a very tight schedule. Dr. Burke, we're going to literally whisk her off the stage and head her out the door because she has to get a flight. So there will be no questions after today. So students, it's like if you've had me in the past, you know what I say. If you have questions, what do? We ask them. We don't wait till after, right? Because if we have a question, look how many people it will help, right? Okay? So if you have questions today, please do ask. I believe everybody was here last night. Anybody not here last night? Just a couple. So we will do brief introductions, and then we're going to get rolling because this was a, like I said, it's a tight thing. One introduction that I would like to do of my full-time, part-time lab assistant faculty. And actually, last night I made a mistake because, you know, I have a list of 2,700 things to do and I made a mistake. We actually have two of our retired faculty here tonight, today, this morning, last night. But Jack can also be listening. Some of you know that. Getting so large. There are people that, Amy and Kathy, that are still manning the table. They help us get our act together to do all this. And we formed a committee. So Miranda Tippy, Rebecca Hare, Lisa Sagmiller, and Cindy Goodwin helped to plan this event today. So thank you to them as well. So, since the majority of you were here last night, I'm not going to run through the big introduction for Dr. Burke, but I will say that today we're really excited that she's going to talk about MOHO and students. Why are we excited about that? Yeah, that's what we teach you, right? And it's part of our curriculum and part of the development of how we do what we do here at the University of Findlay. So we are really, really, really excited. I think the faculty are ready to write copious amounts of notes today. So, We're really excited about that, and we think that what she did last night for you guys, she packaged it really well in thinking about how you can think about productivity and outcomes and assessment. So it was a good, different package to think about and to be big enough to be. Right? So this morning, the title is How Conceptual Ideas Take Hold and Endure the Model of Human Occupations. So without further ado, Dr. James Burke.
Cell phones before it goes off, which I didn't. Okay. And I have to get my yellow cards, which are so fantastic, which I have grouped. Okay, so I hope you don't mind if I, you know, tell you some stories in telling you about MOHO, okay? So, Mary Beth said it would be okay. So if you don't like it, you can talk to her about it. I think the model of human occupation is fascinating when I sort of step back from it and say, you know, what happened here? How did this happen? And that it has endured. I think we first published it in 1980. And it is a very viable, very vibrant, a rigorous approach to doing a systematic approach to treatment, right? To assessment, to treatment, to goal setting, to curricula, such as the curricula here at Findlay. Many schools use the model of human occupation as a curricula. It's useful in a research perspective, and it's I mean, I can't explain it, why it's served the test of time. And I wonder about why it has endured, and so I kind of spent some time thinking about that. Some of you asked in your cards, what's next, do you think? What is, do we need a new conceptual model? I don't think we're ready for a new conceptual model in OT, because this one seems to be so contemporaneous. You know, it works with the culture that we're in now. As cultures change, and it's got so much room in it to reverberate with different cultures, that's again, I think, part of the beauty of it. But it's always fun to talk about model of human occupation, or as my son, when he was little, would call it the ho-hum. Are you going out to do the ho-hum? I was surprised when I heard it called MOHO, because we always called it the Model of Human Occupation, but it was, you know, nicknamed by some of the first adopters. So we'll talk about that as we go along. And so my perspective on MOHO might be different than, I know when Renee Taylor was here several years ago, and if Gary was here, what he would say about it. But I really have always been, have had a historical perspective on life. And I have it on occupational therapy as well. And I think celebrating the 100th year really made me think more about MOHO and where we are in the profession and where we were. Okay, so I entered OT when it was 50, half a century ago. I know I don't look it or act it. But you know, at that time, I talked about this a little bit last night. At that time, we had developed from Slagle, right? And we had developed from the early founders who saw us as rehabilitating or habilitating primarily soldiers and people in the same asylums, and giving some of these basic behaviors, these habits of living, habits of being, routines in their daily lives. That was our job. And we came under the auspices of the American Medical Association. They were our accreditors, so to speak. They oversaw what we did. And it, OT wrestled for many, many years with that oversight from AMA. We're part of the associate, or part of the membership, part of the therapists wanted to remain in the medical model with the medical association, and part did not. Okay, so in around 1958, there started to be rumblings about, should we be moving away from the medical model? And one of the primary proponents of that was Mary Riley. Has anybody heard about Mary Riley after Mary Riley? Okay, so she was really quite, her reputation precedes her. She was from Boston. I met her when I went to USC. I went to USC on a lark. As I said, I went to Utica College, and after I graduated, it was like, what? You know, what about occupation? What are you going to learn now? And at the time I went to wanted to go to graduate school, you had to wait 2 years and get experience. I don't know why they had that rule. And so I applied to graduate schools across the country. And I then, once I got into them, took a tour of the country in a car, in a little Camaro, and stopped at each school, okay, to see if I wanted to go there. And some schools I didn't even go to on the way, like, you know, I aborted the mission. Like, I didn't, and for stupid reasons, like, I didn't go to Fort Collins, University of Colorado, is it Colorado? University of Colorado? Colorado State. Fort Collins, because it was in the school, when I looked at the paper the day before, the school was, the department was in the School of Home Economics. And that turned me off. So I moved on. And then I went to Southern California because the program was going to start in the summer. And my intention was to go then up to San Jose State and the University of Washington. But when I got to the University of Southern California, I met Mary. And the first classes were going to be in the School of Gerontology. We were going to take 9 units in this incredible Institute of Gerontology with these incredibly brilliant people. And I had never been in an intellectual environment like that before, so I was there. I got a nice little cottage at the beach and proceeded with my graduate education. I had saved up money. And I was only in graduate school full time. That was one of Mary's rules. A lot of people broke the rule, a lot of people snuck around and didn't tell her that they were really working, but she always sniffed it out. She had another rule that you weren't allowed to get pregnant. If you ever heard that. She said, you're here to go to graduate school, you're not here to have a baby. And the other rule she had was no marital conflict. Don't get married, don't get divorced, whatever. And I was getting divorced during the time, and I remember it was like a hush-hush thing, and I was like so afraid she was going to find out. And Mary Riley had been a Army OT, and she retired from the Army and moved into the position at USC. Her partner was a woman named Harriet Zlatanovic, and Harriet was the chair of the Department of the University of Southern California, and they developed she moved into a running graduate school for occupational therapy. She was an incredible character. She was a aristocrat of intellectuality. She read tons of books. She said, I was her research assistant, and she sent me to the library, which was right next, the bookstore that was right next door to pick up the books, her recent order of books. And when I went there, the guy said to me, where's your, trolley? How did you get them back? And it was like, this huge box of books, and she would get one of those once a week, and would just go fly through them. And you would, write a paper, and she would, just as she was about to hand it to her, just as she was about to take it, she would say, did you use? And she'd name an author. And you'd say no, and she'd say, okay, take it. So she played a lot of those kind of intellectual tricks on you, which I loved. And, of course, if you're going full-time to graduate school, you need something to obsess over, so this really worked well for him. So what she did, though, was really genius. And she had quite a cadre of friends and colleagues across the country. One of her best friends, Wilma West, for which the AOTF Library is named. Willie was also a Army retiree. She worked in Washington, she worked for the Surgeon General, and she helped craft the maternal and child health legislation and policy after it was passed. And in that policy, she was able to embed money for therapists, occupational therapists, to return to graduate school to get master's degrees. That's how it works, right? You have to infiltrate, you have to be at the table. And Willie was one of those people. She was also good friends with Cordelia Myers, who was one of the first editors of AJOG, and later then the woman, Visseltier, who was in Connecticut and would come once a year to Mary and say, who have you got that could write something good? And that's actually first how I came to be writing in AJOG, because Elaine Visseltier came out and kind of was recruiting authors. All right, so what Riley did was she said that we were at the place in our careers, in our profession, where we needed to have an overarching theory to guide our practice. It couldn't be Brunstrom, it couldn't be Bowman. Remember last night the list. It needed to be something that was about occupation, all right? She called it one of the greatest ideas of the 20th century, and that was her label. That's a great article if you want to read it. In 66 and 69, she started talking about what it would look like to embed these ideas into a professional education curriculum. And she wrote quite frequently about that. And this was really the beginning of the occupational behavior perspective. And are you familiar with that? So that's what came first, was occupational behavior. And as I said, she became serving as the professor and graduate coordinator. She also called for what she labeled this idea of modernizing OT. And this was really, again, genius. She said, you know, we started with this commitment to occupation, right? We wanted to get the people from the insane asylums occupied in activities that were appropriate and that had a rhythm to them in the day. If you look at some of the pictures from the early days, you know, they had people working in the garden, doing gentle activities. We picked out, you know, bookbinding for people that needed to pound, and weaving for people that needed to have some rhythm, some consistency. We had lint tile trivets for people who couldn't keep their attention very long, who were very needed things very precise. They could put a white tile after a blue tile after a white tile after a blue tile. So we knew that activity had a prescriptive quality to it. And she said, let's take these old ideas and let's modernize them. Let's look at what's been done in other professions to forward these ideas. And let's, if they're compatible with how we feel about humans and about occupation and occupation nature, then let's take it and use it and incorporate it into a new model, an occupational behavior model. So she wanted to use this traditional knowledge, and she wanted to update it with information from the social sciences. So you would go to social psychology. You could go to psychology a little bit, but you had to stay away from the reductionist kind of a reward kind of literature on it. She was interested in people that wrote about work, Studs Terkel's ideas about work, risk-taking, decision-making, occupation choice. There was a lot written in the 60s and 70s about people making occupational choices. And again, because of this funding they had, and because of this commitment that she and West had to work with the military, or their background of working from the military, many of their students were fully funded from the military. And one of the classics is Phil Shannon, who wrote about occupation choice. And I was always so envious of him because he worked with soldiers, young soldiers, who were having psychological issues adjusting to military life. And it was like the perfect environment, and it was like the perfect population. And he developed many of the ideas on occupation choice. They had a free ride. I paid my own tuition. But one of my favorite friends was Major Baker, Peggy Baker. She had an apartment on the second floor of this most magnificent apartment building right on the Santa Monica Pier, if you've ever been to Santa Monica. So I tried to stay over there as much as I could. And she had these closets in her kitchen that were filled with canned goods from the commissary, right? Because that's where she shopped. She was endlessly fascinating. Okay, modernization. Riley said that it was not an either or perspective. but it was not only, but also, all right? So she wasn't asking us to get rid of everything that had been done, i.e. Bobath, air now is coming on the scene, frosting is coming on the scene. She's saying we want to add to the approaches that we already have. And she was really quite obsessed with the medical model, leaving behind, and the reductionist perspective that the medical model brought. And I don't know if you need me to clarify that, you can just raise your hand. I would call on you. But you could just raise your hand at any point if you want a clarification about something, right? But she was, I mean, the way she would say reductionist, I kind of remember her top lip kind of curling at the idea of it. And she wanted us to disengage from this very close relationship, this symbiotic relationship we had with rehab, where, you know, we were sent the patients and we were told what to do and only that. And she wanted to see us, as she said, disentangle from that. Again, an interruption in the medical model as the single perspective, an important quality of exploring these behavioral sciences, because she was proposing a knowledge merger. And she wanted to see this forceful and consistent frame of reference that could be used in the educational pursuit and then carried forward into the practice pursuit. Okay, these are some of the ways that she defined it. And she had this notion of the workplace sleep rest continuum. And that came right out of the early days, right, of the insane asylums, where we wanted to give a rhythm, a natural rhythm to people's lives. So we wanted to say, well, what are the components? What's the balance that we call now in our lives, right? I'm trying to strike the balance. That's what she was talking about then. But she called it the rest, place, sleep continuum. Rest, place, work, sleep. Excuse me, now that I'm retired, I forgot that one. So she was very interested in what is it? What is it? What are the qualities of good work? What are the qualities of good play? How does good play feed into making important occupational choices? How does it feed into work? How does it help you balance your life? What kind of risks do you need to take? She really wanted us to have a map or a strategy. Think about collecting ideas, all right? And when you collect a bunch of ideas, a bunch of concepts from different perspectives, psychology, take motivation, from social psychology, take role, take habit formation, from the medical model, take a sensory processing perspective, take cognitive abilities. How do you blend these things, excuse me? I don't know if I'm even using this. I thought I was using this. And what do you do? What do you do? And it's a very methodical approach, theoretical work. And what you do is you group like concepts, and you kind of have a litmus test to say, why does this concept match this other concept? Does it come from the same origins? Does it have the same perspective about human behavior? Does it believe that the human is shaped by internal forces, but also by the environment? Does it believe that the human can impose a will? Right, so you have this litmus test for your concepts. And if they pass, you're able to bring them in to your potential framework. You're able to bring them into your bucket, I'll say, to begin with. And then you start sorting them and saying which ones go with each other. And how do they go with each other? And that's about developing the relationships among your ideas. You know, hence habits and roles seem to have close relationships because based on the roles that you encumber, you have to develop certain habits to enact them. All right, so that's what you're looking for when you're doing that kind of conceptual work. And you might also have to think about how your ideas, how your concepts grow and change. And this is what you'll see in the model, that this is where the idea of this trajectory comes from, that things change over time. And you have to be able to account for that. You know, what does the motivation of a young child look like as compared to the motivation of a young teenager or a motivation of a young adult? And can you look back and see a trajectory for that? You have to be able to explain that when you're doing this kind of conceptual work. So they develop, these are what conceptual models do then. They define the parts and how they relate to one another. They provide a way to systematize your information. And it provides a method for defining problems. Kind of like the data driven decision making, right? It's a method. Like once you have this perspective about performance and about roles and about habits, it tells you I better assess those. And then I better treat where the deficits are. So it provides this kind of methodology. So when Riley set out to do this, she knew what this would require, and this was going to require developing a theory that was very idiosyncratic and specific to occupational therapy. She wanted to construct this playwork continuum. She felt very strongly about it, and she wanted to describe a curriculum, this is like a summary slide, for education, all right? And her ideas were very well received, but there were two forces working against her. One was that she didn't write a lot. She did not write a lot. I mean, the writings that she are very, very precious. She did have one textbook on play, that play is exploratory learning. And she wrote the articles I've showed you, but she wasn't a big writer. She really liked to talk and liked to guide people's thinking. So when you worked with her, you worked really much of the Socratic method with her, where you would talk and she would guide your ideas and then send you off to do the work, and then you'd come back and she'd critique them. The other thing is that she didn't like to travel. And so she was getting a lot of requests to speak, and she didn't want to. She lived on Lido Island in right near San Clemente, and it was really a gorgeous setting. I think she, you know, had worked so hard her whole life, and she just wanted to have a peaceful life of reading and working with a small cadre of students. She believed her students were, if you'll excuse the expression, her disciples of ideas. So she would encourage you to go out and do it. When a speaking engagement would come in, she would give it to one of her graduates. You know, she would say, you don't want me, you want one of my graduates. So those were some of the limitations to her disseminating her ideas, I think. So this allowed us to refocus on occupation. People loved it, as we'll talk about again when we get to MOBO as well. And people loved it because they were people were like me. That's why they went into occupational therapy, you know, about occupation. And you know, they were endlessly intrigued with it. Isn't it incredibly interesting why people choose to do the things they choose to do? I mean, my mother was a stay-at-home worker for most of her life. Although she would go in and help my father work during tax season, because she was the only one that could tolerate his bad behavior. Otherwise, she stayed at home. And she was endlessly active. I can't believe what she did with her time. I mean, if I stayed home, I would put my feet up, put the TV on, and I guess wait until whatever time I can start drinking a beer. this idea that people could engage themselves, it's very fascinating, right? That you can find a routine of behavior. I remember when my mother was like 82 and 83, I used to call her and say, what are you doing? And she'd say, I'm baking, I can't talk. But Or I'm sewing, I can't, I, you know, I've got something that's, you know, someone's waiting for. So this ability to occupy your time is very fascinating to me, because I feel it's, I don't have it as much as other people do, and so I can't, I'm very intrigued by it. She also wanted us to get into this idea of exploration, achievement, and competency. She felt that that was a continuum, and this shows up in the model of human occupation. Many of her ideas show up in the model of human occupation, and I guess in terms of full disclosure, I want you to know where some of those ideas came from, right? But she really thought there was this continuum, and some of you wrote me little yellow notes, which I have to say, they are treasures. I have never received such beautiful questions from a group, so thank you. But some of you said, what do you do once you can, when someone's volition system is not activated and you can't motivate them, and you, or you cannot find motivational qualities? There were a number of note cards about that. And she would say you go to the exploration phase first. You don't ask what you want to do. You give some simple activities that could be pleasurable. And that simple exploration has no negative ramifications. We talked about this a little bit last night in one of the questions. But she would say, you know, you just lay it out and let the person do it, you know, whether it's sorting, whether you say to them, you know, I found this box in the back and I need someone to sort it, can you do it? And they do it, they say no or yes. Or you say, you know, I'd like you to just try to put this together, let's see how long it takes. Somebody just did it in 2 hours and I think that's ridiculous. I think it could be done in 15 minutes. Can you prove it for me? You know, you give these simple, simple tasks that are have very, very low risk. So she was into that. That was pretty interesting. She was also into the function dysfunction, the idea of function and dysfunction, and what tipped the scale for it, and that that's how we could discuss different kinds of behaviors. All right, and so then she has, you know, her list of basic principles. And when you have a model, when you have a theory, when you have a frame of reference, you have to have principles that guide your perspective, you know, that you have to live by. You have to say, you know, does this fit this principle? If it doesn't, I have to discard it or manipulate it so that I can get it to fit. All right, so she felt that humans have a basic need to master, alter, and improve their environments. And we went to social psychology for this. And we looked at even literature on delinquency and how their delinquents are masterful. They master the role of delinquency. You know, thieves master the role of thievery. Look at Soprano. What was his name? Tony. You know, he was masterful in his role. He mastered it. So I always think of this when I'm in the line at the food store. Someone in the front of the line is holding it up. Sometimes it's the clerk. And the clerk's like taking complete control of the situation. And nothing's going to happen. That line's not going to move until that clerk gets it the way that clerk wants it. People want to master their environment and have control over it. She believed in that strongly. Again, it was the delinquency literature. It was the justice system that some of you might be interested in thinking about. People are doing what they're doing because they have a basic instinct to become good at it. Sometimes it's a bad thing, but still it's a basic human quality to engage and to be good, improve, master, and alter your environment. We're all intrinsically motivated. It's a basic human trait. It's been dampened, it's been depressed, it's been shut down in a lot of our people. And the trick is to awaken it. And I'll tell you, that's really why I went to graduate school. My question was about motivation, because I was always so frustrated when I couldn't motivate somebody. And I was always so happy when somebody was highly motivated, and I thought there was some sort of a formula that I could follow to make that happen. We also know that humans, as compared to chimpanzees, well, not so much, but like to be engaged in occupation. That's why occupation science got into much of the work with chimpanzees in terms of their ability to become occupied. We know that the opportunities, the developmental opportunities that you have, shape your occupational skills. And that's why we know it's so important in early childhood to sort of lay down a foundation and enrich environments as much as possible. And then we also knew that family and social networks and cultural influences shaped our occupational performances, our different preferences. And I'm sure many of you have stories about how your own backgrounds are responsible for where you are today, right? Many of us have backgrounds where someone in our family was disabled or is disabled or had some kind of catastrophic experience. Many of us worked early in our lives with people who had special needs. Some of us come from families that were always involved in needy services. And our parents kind of exposed us to those worlds. And that certainly has something to do, plus the fact that you kind of gravitate toward things that you're good at. And so if it felt good and you seemed to make a difference in somebody's life, you kind of got hooked a bit on that, and that fed your interest in moving forward. Okay, more principles, oh my God. Okay, daily routines, time, place, physical, the things you know, right? But this is where they came from. These are the kinds of principles that were laid out. I love the notion that, you know, it is occupation that ensures health. And we are finding this is creeping into the pop culture. If you remember when the Twin Towers went down, there was a tremendous surge in people doing comforting activities. There was a huge spike in knitting sales, for example. There was a movement toward doing more group activities during that time as well, which I think has really continued. But we know that occupation ensures health. It's objective as well as subjective, and where learning and meaning meet is where Riley believed was the juncture of occupation. All right, so how did she go about doing this work? And she was really a traditionalist, and she believed in using your graduate students. So the way it worked was that, you know, you marched into her class the first day. It was only a group of about 15 or 20 people each year. And she sat around the table, and maybe she asked you to introduce yourself, maybe she did, depending on the day. And maybe you said what you were interested in working on. And, you know, it was quite a variety of people, right, who would come to graduate school. Maybe somebody was interested in working on stroke, and somebody was working on hip replacements and some, or orthopedic issues, and somebody else was interested in, you know, Parkinson's disease. And she let everyone tell her what they were interested in, and she said, well, you can set that all aside, because that's not what you'll be doing. And what you were going to do depended on where she was in developing the play, work, rest, sleep continuum, the function, dysfunction continuum, the exploration, competency, achieving continuum. And that's the work you were going to do. And some people resisted. Hung on by their fingernails, it was not working. They went down. Some people finished on time, but they, you know, signed on, and other people just really dug in, and it wasn't pretty. You didn't want to be in those kind of meetings with her. All right, so these are the things she set out for her graduate students to do. And in fact, they did it, because it was so inspiring. It was so unbelievable to be working with this person who had this idea, if you could buy into it, and that you were going to be part of these new ideas. And her scholars, in fact, did remarkable work. They helped us understand work, they helped us understand choice and play. They worked, different people worked on different specific behavioral traits. And also, she said, well, how are we going to think about this systematically? And she imported open systems theory into our thinking. So she had a very good friend who was in public policy, and open systems theory was really cranking up in policy in the early, late 60s and early 70s. And also, USC is quite close to the Jet Propulsion Laboratories in Pasadena, so you know a lot of their news was daily news, was local news, and they were talking about Sputnik or rockets going to the moon and monkeys and so forth, and open systems theory played into those kinds of thinking, because we had to say, if we did this, what would happen? If we did this, what would happen? If we limited the environment to this, what would happen? And so that's what was, it was very useful for occupational behavior, because we didn't know that much about the behavior. We said, what would happen if we gave somebody rules to follow about their roles? Or we worked on habits when there were roles. So open systems theory, which again, I think the model can lead you to think that we came up with open systems theory. I wanted to set the record straight in that it really came from these initial ideas. Could you imagine what it was like to be in her head? You know, just constantly coming up with these ideas. And of course, she couldn't wait to share it with us, or rather lay it on us the next day so we could start working on it. So here's a sample of some of the publications that started coming out of the occupational behavior scholars. So this is the generation that I'm in, a little before my time, but this is the group of scholars that, you know, I really resonate with in terms of occupational behavior, because I was either reading their work, or they were coming in and giving special talks about it, or they were presenting their work. These were, this was hot off the press. So of course, Linda Flory, who's still around and doing a lot of work still with play, just genius stuff, about what play looks like and how it's the scaffolding for occupation. Nancy Takata was a very, very talented therapist who talked about what was a environment in the youth that you could create to induce play, especially in people who were developmentally delayed and weren't exploring and pursuing their interests on their own. Of course, Jan Matsusuyu, who did a great deal on work and play, but also was responsible for the original interest checklist. She was a very, very funny woman who, it followed her around for her, the rest of her life, the interest checklist. Moyer did work in the antecedents of work behavior, and Bailey on vocational theories, Nancy Bailey. This is the Phil Shannon's work that still holds up beautifully. If any of you were working with young men or young women in the military, it's pretty interesting ideas there that you could modernize for the times. But in the military, you kind of have special opportunities. You have a little bit more flexibility, if I'm correct, with treatment times and treatment options. And it's everybody is a soldier, so there's some homogeneity to the population, which is kind of nice, and to the setting. Clavin's work was also in developing a theory of adaptation. Gray's work, you can see that this was the time that the work, play work was going on, all right? From 76 to 83, this is what some of the work looked like in terms of how it was progressing. And this is just really a sampling of it, but I wanted you to have an idea. The role of history was starting to come up now. There's an entire journal devoted to the students' work. Part of getting out of the program was, you know, you sort of had to really be wedded to the idea of publishing. It wasn't necessary, but there was a huge threat. I mean, you could imagine waking up in the middle of the night to a knock on your door. You know, it was going to be Mary asking for the manuscript. So what happened? So as I set the stage for you earlier, I didn't mention that she really turned to her students to be the quote-unquote disciples. And there was, as more people graduated, as more people did presentations at conferences, more people heard about occupational behavior, and they wanted to know more. And at that time, really the only way for you to learn more was to pack up your Camaro, drive across the country, and set up shop in Southern California, and go to graduate school, which was affordable at the time. But people were doing it. You know, people were doing it. And then you would go back to where you came from. Well, I never left there for 20 years, but and spread the word. And so then people wanted to know more. They wanted her to come and speak. And so Gary and I both took jobs in Southern California, and we took very analogous jobs. He worked at the University of UCLA in the Neuropsychiatric Institute in a special program called the University Affiliated Program, a federally funded program, huge amounts of money. I worked in the sister program that was affiliated with USC, and rather than the Neuropsychiatric Institute, it was with Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. And both programs, again, federally funded, both programs were designed to train health professions to work with people who were developmentally disabled and to work in an interdisciplinary fashion. So we were supposed to discover new strategies for working together, which is so funny because of in the professional education now. But at any rate, this legislation that led to the money, the funding, came out of the Kennedy era, because remember John Kennedy? You don't remember John Kennedy. But there's going to be a series on CNN about the Kennedys, so maybe you'll be able to get some info. But John Kennedy had a sister, and her name was Rosemary, who was developmentally disabled. And the family had a very strong commitment to developmental disabilities. So this was his way of honoring his sister, was to put federal legislation in place so that people with developmental disabilities could be moved into society. This was also the time that we started the deinstitutionalization movement, so it made sense at the time, right? So at any rate, Gary and I were in these two jobs, and these two jobs were research jobs, and we were supposed to be writing about interdisciplinary, and we were supposed to be really, you know, changing the world. And so we would meet frequently because we were both like, I wonder what we should do to change the world. And one day we said, and we were supposed to, as I said, submit papers for conferences. And so we said, let's submit a paper about occupational behavior. Let's not do a paper. Let's do an institute, an all-day institute. And we got accepted. And the idea was that we would invite Matza Studio to talk about interests, and we would invite Flory to talk about play, and we would invite Shannon to come and talk about occupation choice. And, you know, we would host the event, so to speak. But we would do our part. You know, I was into motivation, personal causation, what ultimately got packaged into the volition subsystem. But we would have this all day as a team. And it was packed, just like this group. Everybody loved it. And at the end, it wasn't that good. Because at the end, people said, what am I supposed to do with all these ideas? You've given me all these ideas, but how am I supposed to use them? So we went back to the drawing board, and the next time we did this institute-like presentation at a state conference, we decided to group the presentations. And we decided to put like concepts, just like I talked about earlier when you do conceptual work, we decided to put like concepts together. And we decided to talk about the relationships between those concepts. And so we grouped things about performance together. And we didn't label it at that time, I mean, yet, in this first iteration as performance, but we gave a little introduction to it. Now we're going to talk about skill-based performance, where, you know, you really need these building blocks in order to move up. And then now we're going to talk about how skills are chained together into roles and how we support roles, right? And then we're going to talk about, you know, what's inside people's head, the black box, the values, the personal causation, you know, the interests that drive behavior. And at the end, people were much happier because we had given it some substance. And from there, then, we decided to move ahead and write them. And so what we felt we were doing was really addressing some of the critical issues that were current in our team. People were asking, please give us this information. So I would say to you, just to step away from it for a second, what gives a conceptual model its enduring quality? What if it is, it has to meet a need. And as far as I can tell now, MOPO is still meeting a need. And it's, you know, it's working. It's got to be easily understood. This is why MOPO was so successful, because it makes complete sense, right? You can explain this to your mother and she gets it. Or you can explain this to another health professional, I won't name them, and they get it, right? Some people ask on their yellow cards, do you see MOPO being useful in an interdisciplinary setting or with other professions? And my answer is no, I do not. I think it's important to teach people about MOPO. I think it's important to use the concepts and the lingo of MOPO all the time when you're in team meetings and when you're reporting on patients and when you're telling patient stories and giving case scenarios. But I don't think it belongs to anybody but us. I would not be in favor of giving it away. I do like it when somebody that I work with says to me, can you do that occupation choice thing that you do? That's fine with me for them to say that. Right, but I think the modeling of occupation belongs in OT. And you can change, you know, you can be different than me. I'm not going to ignore it. It has to make sense. It has to be logical. That was one of the beauties. It's so simple. It makes sense. It's logical. It has a common language. That was something that was a problem for us in OT. Is that we were all talking about different things. And when people latched on to the model, the concepts were universal, and OTs could have conversations with each other that made sense. And then it brings, I think, a great sense of clarity to a practice that was already being enacted. So it was really quite breathtaking when we went forward with the model, in that people embraced it and latched onto it so quickly. And by then, Gary moved to the East Coast, and he was doing quite a bit of presentation with it, and it really, you know, had just a tremendous reception. So it provided this organizing structure for the occupational behavior concepts that otherwise had not been organized. And it grouped these like concepts. So what happened was that when we went to do the publication and grouped the concepts, we came up with a pictorial model and used the arrows to show, you know, the interaction between the levels and the interaction within the levels and the trajectory with growth and the input from the environment and the export to the environment. We realized that it would be kind of nice. Wouldn't it be nice? We spent a lot of time doing this. We had no life. Wouldn't it be nice if we named this box? And thus we named performance, habituation, and volition. And again, this was pretty well received. We got a lot of pushback on volition. Volition was kind of a foreign term to occupational therapists. I remember Betty Yerkes kind of confronted me on the use of volition and where that came from and should we be using it. And that got pushback. But otherwise, these ideas of naming these spaces were made a lot of sense. So, you know, this evolved directly from them, and it really builds on the shoulders of the people who came before us. Just before we were about to publish the model, we became a bit fearful. We called it, of course, the model of occupational behavior, and in the last moment, we became really fearful. I guess we were working hard, and maybe we were a little paranoid, but we worried, what if this goes live and it's not well received? What if it doesn't make sense to anybody? What if people don't like it? What are we going to do? And what's worse is we will ruin, this is 1980, remember Riley started way back in 58 on this. What if we ruin what is all these years of her work in occupational behavior? And we said, holy, we better change the name. We better put a tag on it so it could be linked directly to us so that we can be lynched and she wounded, right? And all of our cronies will also wound. Fall into the black hole that's awaiting us. So at the last moment, that's why we changed the name to the Model of Human Occupation, just as a paper trace, so that people, you know, could keep it as distinct. And that turned out to be a good idea, because not everyone from the Occupational Behavior School of Thought could buy into it. Because when you went to graduate school, you made your own model, and you made your own system. So not everyone wanted to buy into our perspective of, or our interpretation of what the system was. Okay? And I've already told you this, it's a very straightforward approach to occupation-based problems. It's got a great utility. Some of you asked in your yellow cards, what population does it not work with? And my answer is, there is one. You also asked, what other theories does it work best with? And I would say, any. Okay, so if you are working in the performance system, and you've got somebody with a cognitive disability, you're going to probably go to Alan's cognitive levels and use that perspective. And that's going to fit just fine. And if you're working with somebody with sensory problems, you're probably going to pull from the sensory integration literature and the sensory performance literature, and that's going to be just fine. And if you're working with somebody who has neurological, movement-based problems, range of motion problems, balance problems, you could use any of that medical model perspective. It fits in that box of performance categories. tonight, so I also, some of you asked, oh, well, I guess this is the same kind of question, you know, what else does it fit with? I think one of the most interesting perspectives is PEO. I think it fits. It's another interpretation. I always get mad when someone thinks PEO instead of MOPO, because I don't quite understand what's kind of up with what they're, why they're doing that. I don't think they're that different, but I have some publications where I have those PEO. Certainly, all the dementia work, much of the dementia work uses a PEO model that I have been involved with. So, you know these systems, right? Does anybody want me to walk through the performance systems? You know them so well. Right? My personal favorite, personal causation. I did a lot of work in that. Values, you know. In interests and then the habits and roles. Somebody asked about the environment, and did I think that the environment had, not just one person, did I think that the environment was given enough attention in MOPO? And I think I probably would say no. It was kind of something that got pulled along, and Roanne Barris did quite a bit of work in the environment early on. And I think that's might be why I lean a little bit toward PEO, because it spends a little bit more time on the importance of environment. So that's probably, you know, an area that could use continued work, especially given the varying environments that people live in now and work in now, and as we move toward more virtual environments, you know, where we're going to be able to say to a console on our kitchen counter, make dinner now, I want to eat balls and pasta, right? So as we move toward that, as our clients move toward using more, I'll say artificial intelligence, there's going to be, I think that the environment's going to make a much bigger difference. And it hasn't been given, it's been given a short shift. You know all about open systems, right? Because I could talk for 3 days about open systems if you want. But they're important. You know, they give us guidelines on how to treat information coming in. Really what happens inside the person is a black box. You know, this is something I've never understood. Can you give two people who have the same exact problem two different approaches, and will they get better to the same level, and will they get better in the same amount of time? Did you want to ever try that kind of study? Right? What's the difference? What's the difference in using different perspectives? Using different models, does it make a difference? And we've never gone into that kind of work because we've always thought it wasn't fair to withhold. But I think what you could do is you could find, you know, if you use more of a developmental perspective for performance problems, and you have a friend in Southern California who needs more of sensory integration for developmental problems, you could probably start to pair things up. You know, and look at the differences. But we don't know that, and that's something that, you know, a general systems theory can't really help us with, because we don't know what happens when people get the information. We don't know why two people go to the same movie and one comes out loving it and one comes out hating it. You know, why is that? You know, do you go to the same movie? That kind of thing, the black box of the personal perspective. Okay, so more about open systems, in case you didn't have them. And, you know, the idea that, you know, the utility of MOPO, that it helps with performance problems. Here's a very primitive, but one of my favorite drawings of that model. Some people asked, could the model be used with groups? I think the model, some people feel. I think the model is really interesting in groups, especially when people have different performance problems or people have different habit structures. So, you know, I used to do a lot of adolescent groups, and I used to like assembly line cooking tasks, you know, especially like tacos where the shells would crack easily. And that would freak people out, or that, you know, and they would correct each other on how to do the task. They would sometimes show each other how to do the task, and you would ask them to switch places. You would compliment them on what they were doing. You're so good at this. Do you cook very much at home? Yes, I get into a conversation about that. Everyone in the group is hearing that conversation. And some of the people who aren't cooking at home are getting an idea that maybe they could cook at home. And they're gonna one-up somebody else, right? Or somebody's gonna talk about how they handle that shell and how they handle that filling and whether they put guacamole in it or not, and on and on and on. So I think that the model works quite nicely with a group, because in a group, what you're trying to do is group people who will help you further all of the goals of each individual, right? So you're trying to have role models, and you can have role models for the different components in the model of human occupation, the performance system, in any of the systems, right? Does that make sense? So I think it's a, so these are ways that, you know, this is more about what you want to know. I like to ask about what the key occupational challenges are. So some of you, you know, where do you start with using the model of human occupation, especially when you're stuck with somebody who lacks motivation? They lack clarity in a lot more. You know, motivation is the highest level of the system. It's the most sophisticated level. And really, for motivation to work, every other system has to be in pretty good shape. No, I mean, you really can't be motivated if you don't have some of the basic skills that you need. Because you don't feel, so as soon as you try to do something, you don't feel successful, so you back off of it. So I would say that motivation issues way up here. I'm looking in other places in the system to see where there may be some deficits or dysfunction or need. Right? And then I'm going to think about exploratory competence and achievement, the kinds of challenges. I'm trying to think, somebody else asked a question that was very similar to this. Okay. I'll look at some of the questions. Okay, I'm going to look at some of the questions. Do you have a question? Does somebody have a question they'd like to ask?
Yes.
Wait, you have to talk much louder. You just stand up. Oh, we're going to give you a microphone. And we're going to make it official.
So how do you deal with someone that has negative volition? Like you were talking about a bank robber, where their motivation is negative to themselves or others around them.
That's a good question. You know, I mean, it's really about digging in there and finding out about skills, opportunities. I mean, I think it's about how can you earn your living, you know, and that this is an option. This person has the skills to do it. They can run fast, they can get guns, they can, you know, they're fearless. I mean, I might explore some of those behaviors, you know, there may be some thrill about doing it. But I would really work to explore what the job entails. I would take it as a job. Tell me about your job. You know, tell me what you have to be able to do. What do you do well? And I might show a model, the model of human occupation, in some simplistic way and say, let's build this out together with the exemplary skills that we have. And I would suspect that the performance subsystem would be quite robust, right? You have to have planning skills, and observation skills, and timing, and plus just movement. So I would explore those. And I would also then explore, you know, what kind of habits and roles do you have? What habits fuel your roles? You know, what other roles do you have? What other roles might you be interested in exploring? Can we think about how this set of skills can be incorporated into other kinds of roles? And then getting into the work, you know, exploration of work, trying out different kind of work settings. But it's going to be tough. It's going to be really tough. And it's going to have to be a pretty dynamic job, right? If they get, you know, I mean, you got to give off on being a bank teller, right? And just the first.
That is an example of a negative motivation.
Yeah, I don't think it's a negative motivation. I don't think it's a negative motivation. I think it's a bad job. But I don't think it's a negative motivation. I think the person's highly motivated to be occupied, engaged, and succeed. So I don't see that as a negative volition. So we might want to switch your perspective a bit about that.
Yeah.
It's a maladaptive role. And I guess learning.
Well, don't you think we need to go back to what you said last evening too, about that relationship and the development of trust? Because if you do as you suggest and then explore all these other things in terms of skills and habits and that sort of thing, then you might choose something that you know the person would be successful with, which should in turn perhaps increase their motivation.
Or shift. Again, I don't see it as a lack of motivation. You know, I once worked with a guy I called the Coffee Pot Man. I have a video of him, and he was from West Philly, which is a really rough area, and he was a gunshot wound. You know, was involved in robbery, and he, you know, came to the clinic every day. He was the most different kind of person than me possible. So it was a huge challenge, you know. And he, somehow we got cast in the roles of him helping me. And it happened because somebody walked out, just as we were talking, somebody walked out of the break room and said, the coffee pot's broken again. And he said, I can fix it. And he said, he took it apart. And he said, give me a paper clip. And he put these two paper clips. And then he said, plug it in. And he said, touch it, see if it's hot. And I think I went like this. And he said, no, you never touch it with that part of your hand. You'll burn it. You touch it with the palm of your hand. And that launched a relationship, a rapport, because he was in the role of knowing more than I was open to what he needed. Right? You know, I was ready to listen, ready to hear about it. And you know, he had a successful career, and then he, you know, fixed people in the neighborhood stuff. And I think he fixed everyone from the University of Pennsylvania stuff and from rehab after that. Because that's where he was being treated. But so what's the sign? It's maladaptive, you're saying. It's a maladaptive behavior.
Was that set of motivation or not, because he was motivated, did somehow along the way was sort of this role learned, you know, to rob banks or any other example? Right, was it learned? Could it be then unlearned? and a more adaptive use of the person's volitional abilities be learned so that they can be a productive member of society?
Yeah, I think it could be recast. Yeah, sure. I think skills can be recast all the time. I think we see people making role changes, occupation changes all the time. You know, it's just like, you know, somebody from working at, going from working in a research lab to working in a data analysis capacity in a library. I mean, everybody switches jobs, right? It used to be that, you took a job and you stayed in the job forever. And it's not like that now. People have many different jobs in the course of their lifetime. So I think it's just like, you know, going from being a faculty member to a chair to a dean. You recast them. I don't think there's something, I don't know, I'm feeling like I want to recognize that people choose crime because there aren't a lot of options. And it doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with them, it's just they got into the wrong line of work. Kind of, you know, that's, I mean, that might be quite naive on my part, but I'm sort of thinking about it like that as shift people. Yeah.
I mean, if grandpa was a bank robber and dad was a bank robber and mom was a bank robber and it worked well for them, and so that was your pathway. Going back and providing support for those environments that are healthy and supports.
Yeah. But you say what, that going back and what, looking at the environments that.
Focusing on positive environments.
Yeah.
You have that negative environment throughout your life, and those are the pathways you choose.
Yeah.
But I work in an urban school district, so I think about that environment all the time.
Yeah. It's a certain environment that doesn't have a lot of options, right? But doesn't mean you can't get really good at the options that are there. So somehow that kind of shift has to occur. But it's an idealistic, you know, thought. Okay. So a lot of you asked, you know, was there a right time? What made you think of the model? You know, why did it occur? How did you get the opportunity? And I think I kind of clarified that in the presentation today. So. I'll just say that there were a lot of, you know, what made you, what inspired you. Yes.
What about volition when people have volitional, like, motivation toward things that might not be achievable based on their skills? I used to work with a client who had narcissistic personality disorder, and so their skills would not propel them to the thing that they were motivated toward.
Yeah. Somebody else asked about that also. In terms of motor behavior, somebody asked in their comment, what do you do when somebody, you know, has an expectation to be something that they can't? And again, I think it's us, you work at it. You know, I used to work with a kid who was just charismatic, and he had CP and was in a wheelchair, severely disabled. And lots of spasticity, but charismatic, everybody knew him, and in an outpatient setting, and he wanted to play sports, you know, and it was like, he was already 11 or 12, he was not gonna play sports. Now maybe he could have played, I don't think he could have really even played adaptive sports. That wasn't so much on my radar at the time, but because he had such a charismatic personality and had no problems with speaking, he would be a great sportscaster and ultimately did go into sportscasting. He first started broadcasting at local games and became a hero, you know, to the group. I think what was right about it that made it work was that he was open, he was realistic, way back deep down inside, he knew he wasn't going to be able to make it. And he had such a big ego that it worked when all of a sudden he got a lot of attention for that, that he was able to move on. So I think you have to find ways to help a person that wants to be realized in a certain way to be realized in some variety, some variation of that role that they want to subsume. You know, even if it's in the setting. So I'm not sure, did you say the person wanted to be a certain thing?
They wanted to be like a play writer and a script writer, but they had a mental disability along with narcissistic personality disorder.
That sounds like a script writer to me. Yeah, so, well, that can be a hobby though, right?
Yeah, it was just that, like, his mental capability was not able to write very well. So, but he thought that he was because of the narcissistic personality disorder. It was an interesting case.
Yeah. But again, I think that could be a hobby because you could do hobbies at whatever level you're good at, right? So it doesn't really matter. And sometimes when we give people outlets for their what they are motivated to do, they get some realization along the way about it, or they adopt that performance as a hobby. So try to sideline it, to try to channel it into that. Yeah, but it does sound like an interesting case. Yes? You work with profoundly?
The profound DD, like very nonverbal, no. How do you figure out what their goals are, what they're like? It just is, there are group homes and ICFs where staff are very babysitters, for about lack of a better word. Where
the staff are what?
More like babysitters. They're not engaged with the people, they're not. And so, like, to try and find an avenue to get them to do things is difficult. They don't follow verbal commands, they don't follow, like, to try and bring them to a table, to try and explore. They're not even showing any interest, and it's very challenging for me, especially with lack of staff follow-up for therapy.
What was the age of it?
I work with small children all the way to geriatric. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's a population that's very dear to my heart. My sister is 75 and is profoundly involved and has been in an institution her entire life. And about 3 years ago, she moved to a home with 10 other individuals, medically fragile, and they're exactly that population that we talked about. And the staff issues are big because it's a small group home, and I know they don't pay a lot of money, and I know people take the job and don't know what it is, and a lot of people cycle in and out. But there are some gems in the home, some workers in the home that are real gems, and have a very deep connection to the people that they work with. And if I find that when I go, if I can engage them, I don't go as the OT. I often go when the OT is there. But I find that if I can engage them in a story about who my sister is, that they can buy into that. So I wonder if there are some narratives you can engage them in about who this person is. You know, so, and I think this takes a lot of observation of what people like. And I mean, my sister's life is very, 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 very simple. And she gives a lot of clues. She gives a lot of clues about what she wants. She's totally nonverbal, I don't know if she sees, I don't know if she hears. But she tells me what she wants, okay? So if I go and I'm all over her touching her, she lets me know if she wants it or not, you know, by the sound that she makes. And I joke with the staff about that. You know, what kind of mood is she in today? Because I'm not going to come if she's going to be mad at me. But I think you start to tell these stories. And she likes things like the smell of lavender, the machine that makes the noise machine, hot heated things sometimes, the heating pad, and laying on the plinths. She will go over to the table and tolerate the table where other people are doing some very simple things. So I tell you all this because I think there are very subtle clues, but it's a very simple existence too. So I think you have to think about what your expectations are for your clients.
For example, right now I'm treating a gentleman who falls a lot and has had concussions, TBIs as a result. He's trying to acclimate into wearing a soft helmet. He wants nothing to do with anything on the head. So I've been trying different items on the head, different types of hats, plus different textures, different. And again, it comes back to, I can only be there for my session 3 times a week. And I have very poor staff follow-up. So it's so frustrating, and I just don't know how to motivate, I guess, more of the people around him. Since motivating him is you know.
Right. So what works for Jackie, my sister Jackie, is when something's successful. Because when the OT finds something that's successful, they want to know. Because they don't want her to get agitated. And they makes this moaning sound and they can't stand it. I thought it was just her being vocal, but they interpret it as I guess it's difficult 24/7 to listen to it. It's not that hard. We're there for 30 minutes. But once I find something that's successful, he likes it. And I might give, then they tend to latch on to it. So they might latch on to one small thing with him. You know, like the hat.
I have a comment.
Every morning.
I wonder if there's...
Could you stand up?
Maybe sure.
I
wonder if there's another person in the group home or a staff person that would be willing to wear the object on their head.
Maybe 2 or 3 individuals who wear something similar to what you are trying to conform for him. And he sees that, and that gives him some motivation to see, oh, I'm not the only person who is walking around with a soft helmet on my head. You know, something like that might be an approach to try.
That's a great idea. Yeah, I know, but sensory issues are big in our population, right? And I also feel like, well, I guess it's a hazard for him, you know, it's a danger for him, but I also feel like, you know what, I don't really care if my sister spends the whole day on the plane. I mean, they move her all the time. She's 75 years old. She's never had to do it without crying out loud. So they're doing something right. But and they'll say to me, well, you know, we don't like her to spend all day on the plinth. Why not? Right? What's wrong with that? So I think that's about it, too. But in your case, you're really into a safety issue. Yes. So, I mean, you have to find a couple champions, and you have to find something funny and fun for the staff. That might be funny and fun for the staff. This idea, you know. Yeah. Oh, and I think also, you know, it would be great if you could get the staff for them to tell you one thing they wish that would change about each person. One thing that would be easier for them. Because that's what it's about. It's all about the staff. Good luck. I'll think of you. My sister has a great OT. Oh, Sabella, she's great. She tries all kinds of things. And the OTs change which is really also great because they come in with a completely new perspective on something, you know. So now she's trying to soft splints on her hands. And she didn't think they would be very successful with it. It's the time of the day you do it also, right? That matters, the acceptance. All right, what else? Other questions? Yes.
So my question has like a little bit of background to it. My brother has severe autism. My parents are currently beginning the process of looking into group homes for him. My question is, how do we help to minimize the possible losses in performance capacity and drive when a person is facing a severe environment change and habit changes in someone who might not be able to completely understand what's going on?
Yeah, how old is he?
He is 18 right now. Yeah.
So I think it's going to be a lot about finding the environment that's right. Are there a lot of options?
I'm not entirely sure because they kind of just started the process. Yeah. Since I'm not home at the moment, I don't have a whole lot of information on what they're currently looking into. I know his school system has a group home attached to that they're looking into, but they're also looking into others around the area.
Yeah, I think it's all about the environment, finding the right environment that's going to give him, writing the IFSP for him that preserves the behaviors that you want, because you still get to do that, right? Because I still write Jackie's, or you know, I'm still involved in hers. So I think that's it, really preserving, going in. It would help if you could, are your parents pretty good advocates?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I mean, I think if they could present him with his performance assets and his role behaviors that are meaningful to him and that keep him motivated, a group home is going to want to be a good fit because they're not going to want the problem. Right? They're going to want their machine to move along and for him to complement what they've got. So that's what it's going to be about. It's about fit. And I think there's a lot of great options out there right now, much more than there used to be, because we have such a big population now of people your brother's age who are moving into adulthood, young adulthood, and where the families want to support that individual to move into appropriate roles. So ask about who their OTs are too. You know, what kind of services they get. But I also find that these smaller homes are much better than the larger ones. So if they can stick to small, I think that's good. 10, 12, 15, the most. Sometimes they're chained together through ARC, right? The Association of Retarded Citizens. They still use that name. Unbelievable. Every time I write a check to them, I say, it would be larger if you changed your name. But that's exciting. It's an exciting, I think I would really try to cast it as a very positive, exciting thing.
Are there opportunities for a gradual integration into the new setting? Some of our students will go one day a week to their new
setting.
Still be in classes the rest of the week.
I believe that's how it's working with the program that is connected with the school, but I'm not entirely sure about some of the other places they might be looking at.
Yeah, that's usually how it works. You go for a day, then for another day, and then you do one overnight.
There's an amazing resource in Ohio called Ocali. I don't know if your brother lives in Ohio. Ocali is the Ohio Coalition for Autism and Low Incidence. There's a whole section on their website about transition to adulthood and addressing a lot of strategies for that topic. Might be a good resource to check out.
Are they Ohio?
Yes, Cleveland.
So did you get that resource from her? Did you understand what she said? Say that slowly, what that resource is.
This is on. Okay.
OCALI, O-C-A-L-I. It's the Ohio Coalition for Autism and Low Incidence. You can create a free account on it just with your email address. You should all write it down for students. And there's a whole section on there about transition to adulthood, and it just gives lots of strategies for working with individuals that are making those transitions.
The county DD board is also a resource. This is the time.
The county board of DD, whatever county you're in, they're also a great resource for what group homes and options are available for them. Some counties are way better at PIT than others, but we have a lot of good relationships. The company I work for is involved in, I believe we're in 8 or 9 different counties now, so it varies from county to county how much cooperation and stuff you get, but it's a good resource.
If this is a good time to be autistic and 18, do you know, because things are really coming together now, there's a lot more options than there ever were before. I want to be helpful. Okay, other questions? So just in terms of these cards, some people also talked about motivation and clients reporting to you, I'm not motivated with anything anymore, or you know, this idea of people that are at such a low level of motivation. So I would think about what does motivate people, and some of the basic things that activate the sensory system are often useful. So cooking is always a good thing, because cooking has the smell, and the smell is often really useful in activating the reticular formation and, you know, getting people a little bit more awake and aware. So, and I've always been, I'm a terrible cook, but I've always been a great advocate for using cooking in therapy. So if there's any way that you can do that, and use olfactory. So I would think about some of those senses. Olfactory, I think about audition, you know, people, what kind of music could you have playing or have available for the person? Because some of these low arousal kind of stimuli may be good ways to start people, you know, get people to begin to be motivated, so to speak. Yes.
So as as OTs, our approach is usually functional and based off of like hands-on activities. But when it comes to cognitive delays or motivation solely focused on like technology, TV, iPads, things like that, how do you sort of step away from that and search other areas that they would be motivated in with that cognitive aspect when they can't necessarily communicate things that they truly enjoy, how you seek that out?
So can you talk a little bit more about it, like situated in a case?
So my brother has Down syndrome, and he's solely motivated just to like sit there and watch videos on his iPad all the time.
Right.
And so we struggle because he can communicate, but is a little bit nonverbal. So we struggle because we have a hard time finding something else that he is motivated to do. Now we know what he likes, but the transition to get him to do those things is a struggle. So my question becomes, for those who are nonverbal or for those who have associated issues, what are ways that you find to help motivate them or to find things that they enjoy?
Yeah. And how old is he?
He's 20.
Yeah, so I mean, I think I start to think about what is the normal rhythm of a day when you're 20? You know, or what is the normal rhythm of a day in terms of the things that you want to do, but the things that have to get done? And I kind of like to structure, I kind of like to see it's him being structured around that kind of a cycle of the day.
You know what I mean? So, you know, is the morning really the time that you start to watch, you know, with the iPad? No, it really isn't. It's, you know, in the morning, you know, you're involved in the ADLs, you can be involved in chores in the morning, you can be involved in going out and getting things in the morning. You know, you could be, he could be going out for a walk or going to the gym or whatever it is. Those kind of, you know, that's the normal routine. And then when in the late morning, it starts to be time to start getting ready to prepare your lunch, right? And so, you know, and the morning was used to go to get the food or whatever, you know? So, I mean, I would just think about trying to put some structure to the day that's very typical, right? And decide what is the typical amount of time that you're willing to let him use the iPad. And I kind of structure it into, I don't like to use the word, but reward. You know what I mean? It's you know, sometimes checklists help, you know, this is what has to get done today, you know. I mean, if he's completely independent, you know, in terms of his movement, you know, I mean, I would think that this is somebody I could certainly use around my house, taking the trash out, putting the sorting the recycles. Do you know what I mean? These are customary activities. You have to look at what your culture is and what are customary activities and start to introduce them pretty slowly. But I don't think he's alone in being totally interested in only watching videos on the iPad, right? He represents a great group of our culture. Now, who, if you let them, they would do that 24/7. So think about routine. Think about routines and roles. And rewards for them. If you let money. Or tokens, or, yeah.
It's very
motivated
by food.
It's all about food. Food is hard. Food's hard, especially someone with Down syndrome. Mm-hmm. I don't like food. Yeah. I'm always afraid to reward the food, but do what you need to do. Okay? Other questions? Oh, great. You're getting your staff lucky.
So I had this thought a couple years ago, and then it left me. So I'm not sure if it's going to come out very well. But when I think about the construct of habits, and I think about today's world where Monday is not the same as Tuesday, is not the same as Wednesday, and kind of that older notion of habit training, what are your thoughts on, does the construct of habits need modernized, or do our performance skills need to be modified to meet kind of the chaos of today, or are we just going down a track of dysfunction with the notion that Monday's not the same as Tuesday? And I think about it in terms of obesity and trying to develop healthier lifestyles, and when you look at parents and say, you've got to get them in the habit, and that's just not going to happen. So do you have any thoughts on kind of that interaction between performance skills and habits, or
yeah,
have I said enough to have a question or kind of get your thoughts on it?
I think so. I mean, it's pretty interesting. I think that notion of habits has really, you know, held up pretty well. It's really what it's about, right? You have to do it in an automatic way. Habits are automatic, right? And there is a lot about the day that is the same. You still get up, you know, you still have to do your ADLs in the morning, or whenever, right? There are certain parts that are very much a habit structure no matter what, in spite of all the differences in each day. There's still a basic structure, a basic skeleton of habits that support performance, no matter what. And if they don't,
then you really can't fulfill any roles. Right? You have to have habits to support roles. Right? And you have to find the time to do the laundry so that when you go to work, the clothes are clean. You can do it in the middle of the night, you can do it however you want, you can take it to a dry cleaner, you can do it like that, but habits have to support roles. So I think, and habits are priorities. Habits are built on role priorities. So, I think it's possible to fill your day completely and overfill. And that's probably what the root of the problem is, the overfilling of the day. So you have to back off, and it's a trade-off. You know, and I don't think every day has to be the same, but certainly in the case of a weight exercise diet kind of situation, those are the most basic habits. So you have to find a way to fill it. You don't have to do it the same way every day, right? You can, you know, walk one day, run one day, swim one day. You can do all, you know, this person can do all different things on the day. They can be let off at the bottom of the block and walk home. You know, there's all different ways to do it. It's about priorities, though, and about building in habits. What do you think about it?
I just think from an intervention perspective, when you're guiding families, or in my case, thinking about mothers where they have three different children that they're trying to, you know, guide down a road and develop a family routine that's functional and contributes to the growth of each child, it just becomes overwhelming. So I love MoHo, so I've always thought about, well, where would I, clearly you need to target all of them, but when I think about that notion of get in the habit, that just seems, it's too big still. So in thinking about what you're saying, it's still that the OT's expertise to really help them deconstruct their current patterns of living so that you can help them reconstruct them in a way that's helpful. But that's just been so challenging that it made me think, well, gosh, maybe we need to think about habits in a different way. But when I look in the literature, it's still very fundamental, and you can't get away from it. So I just kind of wondered your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, I would keep thinking about it, but you know, it's almost like I would love to just like take MoHo, all filled out for this family, and erase it, and say to them, okay, what's the first habit that you want to work on? What's the most important thing for this whole family where everyone will benefit? They may not all benefit the same way, you know, but I mean, I think you have to really sort of be very basic in your approach and start very simply, because it sounds like there are so many moving parts that it's overwhelming.
That sparked in me, as well as some of the questions about volition, thinking in terms of, I think frequently as occupational therapy practitioners, we think volition and motivation has to be what you like, what you want, and we don't think of motivation and volition as being driven by what also they need to do.
Yeah.
And so,
yeah,
you know,
that's a great point.
The discussion of habits brought to my mind, particularly with some of the populations that the gains are going to be so small, is what has to get done is part of the volition or the motivation for the program. And, you know, having worked in the NICU, babies can't tell you what they're interested in. You know that they're interested in eating, but what's really important in terms of motivation in any kind of a situation like that, where the client is nonverbal or very dependent, is what motivates the caregiver.
Yeah. Great point. Just like I was saying to her, right? It's not really about, it's about what the staff is going to want, what the mother's going to want.
Right. And one of the things
what that mother's going to want.
One person said to me very early in my career in the NICU was, because it's a very dominant nursing unit, you need to be part of the unit by making the nurses' jobs easier.
That's right.
If you can give them something that will cut off the amount of time that they have to care for this baby, position this baby, feed this baby, you're going to be part of the unit.
Absolutely.
And if you can't, you won't.
Excellent. Perfect. It's right. Motivation is created, right, from this whole environment and all the people in the environment. And what great advice. Yeah. Beautiful. Okay. We've gotten to that time, friends. Right? Close to that time. I think Jackie's point is such a beautiful one to end on, so I'm happy doing that if you are. Okay. Well, good luck. Please email me if you have questions. Ray knows better. Janice.Burke@jefferson.edu. And I don't always answer my email right away if I'm in a remote location, like the gym. But I would love to hear from you. Please feel free to ask any questions or make any comments. All right. Much good luck to you all. Thank you.